Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Student HR Listen Up podcast. Today, I've got the pleasure of having Amit Prasanna of Guardian Tax and Accountancy back again. How are you doing, Amit?
Very well, thanks, Todd. Good to be with you again.
So, Amit, I wanted to bring you back for a number. The last time you helped us a lot when we were going through the coronavirus retention scheme issues. And right now, what a number of our clients are coming up with, or the issues that they're dealing with, is what happens if we can't afford to pay the top-up schemes, you know, as a result of what's happening with the tapering down of the scheme and so forth. So as an overall topic, I wanted to go through a few things that I think would address all of the different questions that people have right now in regarding to defrauding the coronavirus job retention scheme. And, you know, what are employers looking at in those sorts of situations? Or what should they be avoiding? Or what's happening where certain clients are perhaps, you get accidentally falling into the trap by making certain mistakes or so forth. So what I'd like to start off with is, can you tell us a little bit about what's happening with your clients, or what's happening from your experience of people that are, what are the consequences of defrauding the scheme?
Sure. I think these are fair points. And, you know, we're coming to a situation, Tosh, where the scheme is now going to change, start to taper off. So naturally, a lot of questions are coming up. I think it's important to note that, you know, when the scheme was rolled out, initially, it was done in a rush. A lot of details were left out. It was rolled out just to inject liquidity into the economy, into companies,
yeah,
and make sure people have the best alternative to losing their jobs, which is to go on furlough. So when it was rolled out, there was a lot of money pumped out, easily available, and the government relied on the good judgment of employers making claims and ensuring that they're compliant at the point that they make the claims.
Yeah.
So there wasn't, you know, it's fair to say there wasn't any too much consultation or warnings or any, you know, how-to guides on how to do this. I mean, we obviously put out a lot of information, yourself and myself included, to help people. So when you say defraud, I think that's a pretty strong word in extreme cases. Defrauding would be where you intentionally mislead the other party, in this case, to claim furlough payments when you shouldn't have been claiming furlough payments. Now,
yeah.
There's a lot that can go on that can put you foul of the furlough scheme without the intention of defrauding. So you can go wrong in many cases. Like for the consequences that you asked about, let me just cover that for a second.
Let me go into that, Amit, just very quickly. So yeah. So the issue is furloughing, right? Furloughing means that they are not doing work in a nutshell. So the defrauding scenario is what, say again?
No work. So it's not even a little bit of work. If you're furloughed, you do not work. It's that simple.
Correct. So the defrauding issue will be where employers are blatantly saying to their staff, look, I'm claiming under the scheme, but you're going to do your job anyway, sort of thing. So that we'll get into the consequences of that. Then there's people who might do a work email for something or, you know, one thing that they just quickly needed to do. Does that one email scupper the whole process? So let's start with the consequences, but those are the kind of questions that seem to be coming up at the moment.
Sure thing. So the consequences are very straightforward, actually. It's up to 200% of your overclaimed amount plus taxes. So if you've overclaimed, which could be some or all of the amount you've claimed, if someone should never have been furloughed or they were working and you claimed furlough anyway, essentially the entire amount you claimed in furlough payments for that employee times 200% plus tax would be your potential liability on that. Now, if you should have claimed £500, but you claimed £600, your overclaim is £100. And so your penalty would apply to that overclaimed amount. So I think the consequences are quite straightforward. If you've made this claim incorrectly or overclaimed furlough payments, that's the consequence. And how much between 0 and 200% you are penalized, a lot of that will depend on how the government view you as having made this erroneous claim. Was it intentional? Was it a mistake? So you mentioned email, for instance. If it was an email sent without thinking, you know, it's a trivial breach of the requirements, I'd expect you to be at the lower end of the penalty scale for that.
So it's a discretionary spectrum. It's not just automatically 100%. It's dependent, which makes sense.
200% up to. There will be some discretion, I'd imagine. Again, we haven't seen this in practice, so we don't know exactly how it'll work. But the pattern of penalties at HMRC's end is often based on their interpretation of how this underpayment or overpayment was came about in the first place.
Yes.
And if they believe that it was an intentionally misled, or the claimant intentionally misled them, the penalties would tend to be at the high end, or at the extreme high end.
Yep, that makes sense. So that's the situation where they are defrauding it, or depending on how badly they've done the situation, I suppose. So going forward, the next part of the scheme relates to the tapering off. Do you want to talk about that, Amit? What's happening in July, August, September, October, or I can dip in whenever you want me to, quite frankly.
That's okay. So so June, July, I mean, we're in July now, and everything continues as normal. So let me just recap what's happening right now. Right now, the government are paying 80% of someone's salary up to a maximum of £2,500. The employer has a choice, but not the obligation, to pay the balance 20%,
yep,
on top of the 80%. And the employer does not have to pay any national insurance or pensions contributions on the furlough payments that they receive for their staff while they're furloughed. From August, the month coming up, the 80% will still apply to a maximum of 2,500. But employers will be required to pay national insurance and pensions contributions on that furlough payment. Okay, so that's what's changing in August. From September, the 80% contribution from the government reduces to 70%, and the employer is obliged to pay at the balance 10% plus national insurance and pensions.
Yep.
In October, that 70% reduces to 60%. So the employer will be required to pay an additional 20 plus national insurance and pensions.
Yep.
And the employer still has the choice of whether to pay the additional top up to take the salary up to 100%. Of course, that choice remains. But the government will be reducing their contribution from 80 down to 70, then down to 60 by October. And the employers are required from how the rules are, how the criteria is currently stated, to top up that 80%. So the delta between the 80 and the 70 and 60 that the government pay will need a top up from the employer.
So put it another way, throughout that entire period, the employee should see no difference in the scheme. They're still receiving the 80% of their salary, because partly paid by the government, partly paid by their employer. What happens if the employer does not do the top up that's required during September and October?
It's a good question, and quite simply, we don't know. I mean, it's stated that the employer is required to pay, but what's not stated is what happens if the employer cannot pay or doesn't pay. I mean, where employers are in a cash crunch and they can't top up someone's salary, it leaves them in an awkward situation of not knowing. So if you were to look at HMRC's guidelines on this, there isn't any guidance on what to do if you cannot top up. Do you make your employees redundant? Do you intentionally take it furlough payments knowing that you're not going to top it up? Because the government won't be checking at the point they pay you out. At the point they pay people out their furlough payments, they won't be checking if an employer is paying the additional 10 and 20%.
Yeah.
It's not practical for them to do that. So they're going to rely on employers to be topping it up. And doing, you know, following the rules set out under this scheme. Where employers don't do that, you probably won't hear anything from HMRC for some time, because there's no physical way for them to check at the point of payment. But some point in the future, they may come across this, because
there's two things there, isn't there? One is they're requiring employers to retain the records for at least 5 years, which indicates how long they might be investigating these sorts of things. I suppose, we haven't got any inside knowledge or anything of this sort of thing, but I suppose what makes sense is, if the requirement for the scheme is that you have to top up and you fail to do so, you're not meeting the requirements of the scheme, which then I presume in theory means that they should be paying the money back. Does that make sense?
Well, this is it. I mean, you're not meeting the... It's important that, you know, when to note also, you're actually going to have to report under RTI every time an employee gets paid, even if it's under furlough.
Yeah.
So whenever you make a salary payment, as any employer would know, an RTI filing is made at that point. If you make an RTI filing and it doesn't have the full 80% on it, and rather it has less than 80% because that's what you've actually paid them, you're basically, that's one way of reporting that you've underpaid, number one. Number two, if you report that you've paid the 80%, but actually you haven't, you'll be in breach of the employer's regulations, which, you know, you'll be familiar with, Tosh, that requires you to make sure your employees are paid within a certain amount of time of the payroll run running.
Yeah.
So there are all sorts of implications for this. I think employers need to get help before they make any choices on this and just know their position before making any further furlough claims once the scheme starts to change from next month.
Okay, so I think the message is effectively, look, if you're doing it on purpose, you can look at a 200% penalty effectively. If you're not doing it on purpose and you do it by accident, well, they'll just look at the factors to determine what needs to be paid back or doesn't need to be paid back. Because a mistake is still a mistake. As for the tapering off part of the scheme, which will start next, actually starts in September, but the next month is the pension contributions and the national insurance contributions. Well, then there is a question there about what will actually happen. But effectively, you're the requirement to be eligible for that requires you to do those things. So if they're not topping it up, there's going to be some fallout as a result. How can you help? How can you help clients get around these things or get through these things? What kind of things can your firm do?
Okay, so we've been working closely with our clients to firstly enroll and make the furlough claims for their employees. So we've been assisting clients throughout the process, making sure that the claims are eligible for a claim, consulting with them on their eligibility, advising them on what their obligations are, how to go about making the claim, and actually processing the claim with HMRC on their behalf. So yes, that's something we'll continue to do because it's actually a fairly straightforward scheme. But if people are in a situation that, you know, they don't quite understand it, we won't blame them. I mean, we do this for a living, so we can process things fairly quickly and easily. And we have very good contacts with HMRC to make sure that things are done in the right way. So if people are in doubt on their eligibility or would just like some help making claims and making sure they're compliant, that's where we can step in and make sure that things are done in the right way and the right amounts claimed and people aren't falling foul of this criteria, which frankly is a little bit ambiguous in parts.
So, Amit, you know what we do with these podcasts. We send out all of your contact details when this podcast goes out. I'm going to invite everybody, please, if you've got any questions, contact Amit. He can help you through this process. Amit's firm, Guardian Accountancy, actually Tax and Accountancy, actually are our firm's accountants as well, so I highly recommend them. Please do reach out to him. He's a hell of a guy, putting some good out there as well. So he will help you. He will help you get through those sorts of things, especially when you just don't know what you're doing at the moment or you're stressed about what consequences there might be or what have you. So do reach out. Amit, thank you so much for participating in this again. Really useful. You know, we always get a lot of feedback from these sort of practical tips just to sort of get around or navigate through these sorts of problems. Thanks a lot.
My pleasure. Thank you, Josh.
Thank you, everybody, for watching. See you again next time. Bye for now.